Joe and I particularly, and then I met Valerie later, go back a long time when I was doing the first documentary Uncovered about the reasons for the war and had done no documentaries. I actually cold called Joe because he'd just written the piece in the New York Times where all hell broke loose. And to his eternal dismay, he not only answered my call, but he actually agreed to be in the video. And it was actually critically important because if you remember back at that time, people were not speaking out against the war. There was a terrible amount of fear and cowardice. And Joe's joining and participating opened the door to all kinds of other people who came along and said, oh, Joe was doing it, and they were doing it. So it was like the good housekeeping seal of approval, or as my grandmother would say, it made it kosher. And many joined us after that. So thank you for that, Joe, and thank
it's
you.
It's good to be with you, Robert.
It's good,
good to be back with you.
Yes, and thanks for,
thanks for
both
having
of
us.
You joining us. So I know you both have read both of the books, and now there's a film out, which is the reason that we're lucky enough to get them both here today. So I'm going to ask you, Valerie, first, being the more retiring person among the two, what made you decide to agree to have a movie done? And what concerns did you have, and how do you feel about the film?
Well, let me start with the last one. We are delighted with the film, with Naomi Watts and Sean Penn. We could do worse.
Yes.
Two actors at the top of their game. We have no control over how it will ultimately do, but I really am. I think it's a really great piece of film, and I don't claim any objectivity, but we are proud of it and pleased with it. I didn't even consider writing my book until I resigned from the CIA in 2006. So I wrote the book really as sort of self-help therapy. We had lived through this at 110 miles an hour, trying to go, oh, what just happened? So I wrote my book. With that, Joe already had his book out, and then we were approached. And I have to say, initially, as you know, this is just going to stir the pot all over again. I wasn't sold on the idea. I certainly didn't write the book, and I know Joe didn't with his either, with that in mind. But film does have a way of emotionally, viscerally reaching people that maybe other mediums cannot. And we've had a peek into the world of Hollywood, and it's amazing that any film gets made. It's a long glacial process, but it finally has, and we're here, and we're delighted with it.
And did you have any hesitation or reservations about going forward with a film, Joe, at any point in
oh,
the process?
Oh, no, you know, in for a dime, in for a dollar. Yeah, what the heck? And somebody said today, I think it was Tavis Smiley, said, are you prepared for the right-wing backlash and reaction? Mm-hmm. And I said, well, if it was me advising them, I would advise them just to let it go. But if they want to engage in round two, that's fine. We will fight round two, and you'll all get to see the sequel.
Well, that's a perfect introduction to one of the clips we picked. When you do, you're on the phone and you're telling Valerie, we must fight back.
Hey, you're welcome.
Hello?
Valerie, turn on MSNBC.
Okay, hold on one second.
They've launched an investigation.
Ashcroft just announced it. They say he's going to convene a grand jury.
Hold on a second.
If the FBI now is conducting a criminal investigation into who leaked the name of the CIA undercover...
They want me to comment on the investigation.
Ambassador, Joe, just hold on.
We've got to fight this.
We cannot. We've got to push back.
And tried to buy enriched uranium and not... Yeah.
I've got another call. I got
to
go.
Joe!
Joe Wilson.
Joe, it's Chris Matthews. I just spoke to Carl Rove. He told me, quote, Wilson's wife is fair game.
How close to reality is that particular moment? When did you find out and how did you find out and your reactions, each of you, to that horrible quote?
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, it's really true to real life. And mm-hmm. so Chris did call me, and in his own breathless fashion, he said precisely what he said. And then he said, I got to go, and hung up. So that's when we knew. And fair game, of course, is a term that is used by hunters when game is in season. Mm-hmm. It's okay to go out and hunt my wife. As you can imagine, my reaction was something that is probably not, you probably can't repeat, even in an R-rated interview.
for me, I think it would be accurate to say that after my identity was betrayed, I really was shell-shocked. And I think the character, you know, Naomi portrays that, this, and that's really how it felt in real life. What am I doing? This is, Joe already was five chess moves ahead of what needed to be done, how to react. I wasn't there yet. It took me a while because, of course, you know, instantaneously I lost my career. I'm worrying about my family's safety, and all the assets that I had worked with over the years are in jeopardy. And so I just felt I didn't know what to do.
I think it's important. One of the things that's sort of lost in all of this, there are really only two salient facts of this particular story. One is that I wrote an article for the New York Times which challenged the administration's use of intelligence. And the other is 2 days later, the president's spokesman came out and said to both the New York Times and the Washington Post that, guess what? The 16 words, the famous 16 words, which are the British government has recently learned that Saddam Hussein sought significant quantities of uranium from Africa. The press spokesman said Wilson was right. They should never have been the State of the Union address. Everything else from that point on is manufactured. It was manufactured by the administration as a disinformation campaign and as a character assassination campaign. And from that point on, we were playing defense.
And what about, I mean, there's so many things to talk about here, but Valerie, one question I hadn't seen the film, how, I don't know how much you can comment or not comment on some of this still, but the depiction of the assets whose lives were endangered in Iraq particularly because of revealing your identity, how close to truth is that?
In general, the whole movie is very accurate. Obviously, it's a Hollywood movie, and these events happened over a period of time. It's been condensed. You have to make a story. You want to tell people. But and so in the cases specifically of they depict an Iraqi scientist, I would say that's a compilation. When I was outed, the CIA did a damage assessment I never saw. I think what I can say is I know what happened to some of them. In other cases, I do not.
And I can't imagine, knowing the honor and integrity that you live by, what went through your mind knowing that these assets, these human beings, were endangered. And was there anything you could have ever done about it?
I found it absolutely horrifying, of course. When you establish a relationship with someone who agrees to place him or herself into jeopardy, their families, because they are relaying, hopefully, good intelligence that we then give to senior policymakers. The deal is that you protect them and that you are looking out for their security. Not, you know, as they say, not all of them are Boy Scouts, but they deserve at least our protection if they're going to offer up this information. So as you see in the film, the war begins and assets are left behind. What do you do? Really morally difficult time.
Yeah. Well, I wanted to talk a little bit about the personal side of this without becoming the profession that my entire family is in, which is therapists, by the way. So if we could show the scene on the staircase, and then we'll do the therapy session here with Joe and Valerie.
Hey. Should I wake you?
It's 3:45 in the morning.
I gotta be at the airport in 45 minutes.
I don't know where you go. I don't know who you meet. I don't know if you're in jail somewhere, in a ditch somewhere in Jordan, Beirut. And if you went missing, I couldn't tell anybody because you were never there. I don't know where you go.
Most marriage counselors that we know consider it a miracle that we're still together.
Okay, share the secret to that miracle.
Our view is we tell people that we've been married now 14 years, but we really think we've been married closer to 40 just because we've lived such a
It's been condensed.
And what was the Was there one moment that was toughest on the marriage throughout this whole experience, or a couple that stand out? Mm-hmm. And I want each of you to answer separately, as a good counselor would say.
Oh. Okay.
You go first, sweetheart.
Smart!
She's a good shot with an AK-47.
The truth is, there were many moments that were really painful, and watching some of these scenes where the marriage is fraying still, although I've seen it several times now, it really hurts every time, because nothing is more important to me than my marriage, my family. But you're setting up here, I don't know if you'll show it, but the clip where the Senate Select Committee on Intelligence, about a year after the leak of my name, came out, and it was a highly charged partisan report that accused me of having, of nepotism, of having sent Joe on this trip. And Joe was infuriated. I mean, it spilled over onto me, but I mean, as you can imagine, all these external forces are having a role. But they came, of course, they go through the email systems and they pull up an email in which they said, oh, see, she's recommended her husband, when in fact that my boss had said, Valerie, have Joe come into headquarters. We want to talk to him about this report. Can you write up his credentials in an email and I'll bucket up the chain of command? Of course, you know. So he felt, as in this scene shows, that I should speak out and go public, and because both of our characters, our integrity, were under severe attack. I was still employed by the CIA. I was still very much in, I have to say, a frozen mode, not knowing what the right path forward was.
I've learned out of this that the most two important words in a marriage are yes, dear. So I agree with everything she says. Yes, dear. It's true. The defining, the really sore spot in the marriage for a number of years was this SSCI report and the way they characterize what the Valerie's email up the chain of command, and the fact that I didn't know about it. And I had been out there for years saying she didn't send me. And of course, she didn't send me. I knew that. She knew that. But I was not aware of this email that she'd sent, which outlined my bona fides for undertaking for coming into the agency to discuss how you were going to answer the vice president's office's question. And in fact, in that meeting at the CIA headquarters, something that is lost, that is in a memo, the same memo that contains Valerie's name, this famous State Department memo. In that memo, it says that of all the analysts from around the government who were in that meeting, there were two people who said it's not necessary to send anybody to Niger. One was the State Department, and the other was Joe Wilson. Mm-hmm. So the idea that somehow I was angling for a trip to Niamey, or that this was a setup job, I went in there and I said, there's no reason for you to send anybody.
And on the political side of it, so have your political views changed, Valerie, as a result of this experience, or one part of it, the personal, and then just in general, what do you think can or should be done in terms of the CIA?
Look, whether you work for the CIA, or you work for the State Department, you're in military uniform, when you serve overseas, you serve as an American. You do not serve as a Democrat or Republican, but you are there to represent your country in whatever capacity. And that's exactly how I felt. Both Joe and I actually come from Republican families. But that party of that time was far different than what we are seeing today. What I would say is, for me personally, when all this sort of blew up, I think it's fair to say that I had an extremely steep learning curve in political Washingtonian machinations and the political maneuverings that go on. I've always voted and felt I was proud to serve my country, but I didn't really see, because I was living overseas for a long period of time, I didn't see things through that political prism. I think it's fair to say that for the country as a whole, starting from the 2000 election on, we have become much more polarized. Now it is not considered gauche to talk about politics at the dinner table. So I think everyone is a little more energized.
And is there any sort of changes, any positive changes that you can see that came out of this experience, either in the Washington culture or in the CIA? Or if there isn't, are there any things that you've dreamed about, or if you could make anything happen?
I think this is a timeless story. It's one that repeats itself. A friend of mine who saw the movie the other night said that he likened the movie to All the President's Men meets High Noon, and in the political context in which High Noon took place. But I think, you know, going as far back as the Founding Fathers in our own country, the debate has always been about power and how to keep power in check, how to make sure that one branch of the government doesn't become too powerful, how to ensure that a citizen's rights are guaranteed, in a First Amendment, the last clause of which says, no law should be passed to abrogate a citizen's right to petition his government for the redress of a grievance. I think all that is a clarion call to citizens to exercise their responsibilities. The great aphorism in my mind is when Benjamin Franklin left Independence Hall and he was asked by a lady on the street, what manner of government have you bequeathed us? And his response was, a republic, madam, if you can keep it. And the way you keep a republic is you keep holding your government to account. Our story just happens to be the latest iteration in that struggle to keep power in check.
Mm-hmm. And do you feel more comfortable now, Valerie, speaking out? Do you still miss the CIA and your sort of behind-the-scenes role?
I do. I thought I had the greatest job ever, and that's no longer available to me. If none of this had happened, we would be overseas right now. I would be working on the issues that I was working with at the CIA, counterproliferation. But that's just not a path that's open to me. One, sort of speaking to your last question, for me, one positive that has come out of this is that I do have a more public voice, which I find uncomfortable, but I just close my eyes and hope for the best, and I can apply it to something I care passionately about, which is the whole issue of nuclear, the nexus of nuclear proliferation, thank you, and terrorism. Mm-hmm. And I'm working with people like Global Zero. I appeared in a documentary, Countdown to Zero, which looks at here's where we ultimately need to be is the total elimination of nuclear weapons. So I've been able, this has granted me a more public platform to continue to work on something that I care about.
And what about when you're in the CIA, the need to keep secrets, to give people a false identity? Again, knowing you only in your public life, I can't imagine how that must have pulled or affected you in some way internally to have to put on the false face?
You're trained for this, and you have your cover for a really good reason. One, it's a burden to tell anyone, and they have to carry that. And secondly, you are protecting those who are providing intelligence. I didn't see it. It's a little strange when you finally do get out of the CIA and you look back, you go, that is maybe a little odd. But there's a reason that you do it. I was very fortunate. When all this happened, I had a group of girlfriends that I've known since my college years, first year in freshman dorm. They simply said to me, well, we're so sorry, but what can we do to help? They understood. They are my friends to this day. And so I loved what I did, and it was simply part of it.
Strange. One of Valerie's friends was actually pleased to learn, because she had been concerned that Valerie's peripatetic travels around the world meant that she was an international gangster's mall or something. But she was very effective. I remember when I was first dating her, she was living in an unnamed Western capital, which was Brussels. And I used to go up there and take her to dinner. And I thought to myself, well, if this dating of her doesn't work out, she's an investment, she was in venture capital investments and stuff like this. I thought, I'll slip her my CV. Maybe she can get me a job in her sector. There comes a time in the relationship when you decide you're going to go, you decide there may be some future in it. And she felt that it was appropriate then to gauge my reaction to the fact that she was a clandestine CIA operative. And she did. And I asked one question. I said, is your name real name Valerie? And she said, yes. So I went back with trying to court her.
He seemed okay with that.
At the height of all of this, Joe, you had a huge political impact in a big public voice. Do you miss any of this now, or are you glad to be out of the, I mean, you're on a press tour now, so it's probably not the exact right time to ask you, but how do you feel about, I know we've emailed and all about taking a step back and away from some of the...
Well, I think, you know, our story is now part of the history of our country. It's no longer quite as raw and emotionally and politically charged as it once was. Although, again, if the right wing decides they want to go another round, we'll go another round.
I know you will. But, look at Valerie's response, Joe, before you answer.
But,
we have it on tape.
But I think, I mean, I always really wanted to talk about the policies. I felt that it was important, as somebody who had served in Baghdad and was in charge of the embassy in the first Gulf War, that my voice be part of that debate. And my voice was really based upon my experience there, my experience with the Saddam regime, was that we really should think long and hard about whether or not the particular action that was being proposed by the neoconservatives in the Bush administration was in fact the best foreign policy decision we could ever have made. I don't presume to get involved in issues about which I know nothing. I don't want to sit there and be a pundit for the sake of being a pundit. That doesn't interest me whatsoever. But if there is something where I have something to add to the conversation, then I think it's appropriate, again, exercising your responsibilities of citizenship, to be out there in the public square and be part of that debate.
Let me ask you something else that's a little bit related to this. I mean, you spoke out because they were distorting the facts, right? And distorting the facts that you had particularly.
Well, remember, there's two parts of this. One was the run-up to the war, which is whether or not, you know, somebody was going to stand in front of the neoconservative juggernaut and say, this doesn't make any sense. It is not an existential threat. It is a waste of our assets to go in and do this. Mm-hmm. There are other ways to do it. That was based on having been in Baghdad and having been a political advisor to the Commander-in-Chief of U.S. Armed Forces Europe when we ran the no-fly zones over northern Iraq. So that was one of them. The second one was holding my government to account for what my government said and did in the name of the American people, specifically when the President of the United States went down on the floor of the Congress and lied to the Congress and by extension to the American people about the case for weapons of mass destruction, and particularly the nuclear case.
Thank you. Okay, so with that in mind, WikiLeaks.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, I know certainly from within the government there's all kinds of different beliefs, but having read some of it, by no means all of it, it's horrible, it's heartbreaking, and it seems to be unquestioned that it's truth coming out. Would mm-hmm. you support the fact that the WikiLeaks release?
Yeah, there's two parts of that, as I see it. One has been the allegations that, in fact, sources and methods were compromised, mm-hmm. in which case what the WikiLeaks leak was essentially exactly what Cheney, Libby, Rove, and Armitage did to Valerie. They leaked the names of assets, mm-hmm. Which should be protected. The other part of it, of course, is real factual information that it seems to me you can make the argument that a lot of it was classified simply to protect those who were involved in really bad decision-making, so to save them from embarrassment mm-hmm. or accusations of misfeasance or malfeasance. And that goes to the question of whether or not government should be more transparent. And yes, government should be transparent as possible. We should know. And that part of the... A lot of what I was involved in was getting the government to fess up to the fact that it lied to the American people. And I'll go back to what I say repeatedly. These were grave decisions that we took as a society to send our fellow citizens off to kill and to die in our name. We had a right then and we have a right now to know why we did it before we send them and not afterwards. And we were let down. We let ourselves down in this debate. We were let down by the Congress. We were let down by the press, who didn't assiduously enough follow the storyline. And those of us who fought the fight not to go to Iraq were just simply outnumbered and out-organized mm-hmm. by the neoconservatives who had been plotting this for, you know, well over a decade.
I would just add to that I have a profound sense of ambiguity over WikiLeaks, for all the reasons that Joe articulated. I believe in a strong intelligence service. One, it's necessary. That's the world we live in, and some information needs to be collected clandestinely to provide to senior leaders. Hopefully, they make wise decisions with it. But when it spills over into the area of, well, we're just trying to protect. Part of what really struck me, there was much information that came out, was actually how much higher the number of Iraqi casualties has been than anyone knew, and. it is so heart-wrenching, really. And why would they keep that from us? And that's the sort of thing that I find WikiLeaks finds a place. I don't know the fellow who runs it or any of their leadership, but I think that they are still sorting out the moral implications of what they're doing.
And as somebody who used to have responsibility for classifying documents when I was chief of mission and deputy chief of mission, I can tell you from experience that everything is overclassified.
Yeah.
Everything.
Because it's easier.
And you do it just as a matter of routine.
It's safer to classify.
Yeah.
So they're signaling us that we have to end. So the last question to each one of you, your president or king or Napoleon or whatever it is, and you can change one thing in the government today.
Mm.
What one thing would you change?
I have a good idea.
Well, go ahead.
Okay.
He needs time to think.
So. Yeah, well, if I were queen for a day, I would overturn, I get to do a couple things. I would overturn the Supreme Court decision on Citizens United and reform completely. I would take that part of the puzzle of our politics, of the money and the foreign money and the opaqueness of where, you know, all of the problems, and somehow snap my fingers. I don't have all the solutions, but I would snap my fingers to make it right. I don't like the fact that a corporation has all the voices and all the money at the, you know, and it counts equal as an individual in terms of how the Supreme Court has seen it. I find that is deeply distorted our political system.
I think that's pretty good for me.
What?
It's not often you see us come to agreement this easily or this quickly.
Oh my goodness.
Really?
I think there's nothing more important than reforming the electoral system.
Oh, okay.
To allow really one man, one vote, one person, one vote.
Yeah.
And the idea that some international corporation, because it has more dollars to throw into the public square, has more votes than I do, or a louder voice than I do, I find outrageous.
It's infuriating. Mm-hmm.
Well, hopefully on your next trip back, we'll talk about that in more detail.
We'll fix that.
And we're working on it. Yeah. So thank you.
Thank you very much.
And I've got a plane to go.
Thank you.